Lucas will pick this up from the point of just yesterday. We got the 7 on the rudder, and we're ready to obviously go on to the next step here. He spelt murderers wrong. Oh, will this idiot ever learn to spell? Spell M-U-R-D-E-R-E-R-S. Even in my own shop, no dignity in life. All right, ego trip's over. Done. Finished. Let's get on with it. Now this is just one quick thing I wanted to put on the video. I had this marbleizing kit, and you know I got all this old furniture, which is in pretty rough condition, and I've been trying to fancy it up or whatever. This tape, I used a marbleizing kit. I'm touching it up now, the little spots that were scratched. And I want to put this epoxy, and this may be something somewhere in the world of model aviation we can find a use for. This two-part epoxy that you decoupage tables and things with. Well, I did a couple items with it already. I did a sink upstairs, and it really seems to work good. Now, I'm using other technology that Walt Prey, the aluminum foil and the taping system, to keep it from going out over the rest of the table. But if you saw this up close, you'd notice this is really a pretty nice marbleizing job here. And they give you this little kit. They give you all the little things you need. If you have a piece of old furniture, like, I know guys like Steve DeJulia's wife is going to have him marbleizing things in nothing flat. Thomas Mann's wife probably has 8 or 10 things she wants marbleized. So anyway, you can see how this works. It's real easy to do. Don't be afraid to try it. And basically what you do is you have a feather that you draw into the marble, and it puts the marble veins in it. Is what I'm trying to do right now. This is really just a touch-up. This has already been marbleized once. But that epoxy, I want to try that epoxy coating. The trick of the epoxy coating is to take a torch and go over the top of it after you apply it, and it leaves such a nice coating. It's unbelievable. Now what this is a two-part epoxy mix, and boy, I wish we could find a way to use this in model aviation to do finishes. In one coat, this leaves like a glass-like sheen on it. You've probably seen this commercially. It's called decoupage. Decapore, it goes in some other names or whatever, brand names, whatever. Anyway, what you do with this when you're done marbleizing, and that marbleizing kit is real easy to do, you just kind of randomly put this on. And just show this real quick. This is really something nice. And if you're into old furniture like we are, we're into old furniture for a good reason. We can't afford new furniture. It's really, really a nice thing. Now, believe it or not, the best thing I've found for this kind of work is this spreader that we use on doing fiberglass work. And you can see how this stuff just smears on like all epoxy. Now, the problem is, if you're refinishing an old piece of furniture, when you're done with this, there's air bubbles in it. And the trick to getting the air bubbles out, I'm going to show that with the torch. I would not suggest you try that on a foam wing, even though it does work good on furniture. I don't think it's appropriate for foam wings, but this is certainly one of the things I have to find some use for in finishing, maybe even in coating lettering or sealing gas tanks or something. This material just leaves a shine like you can't believe with no work at all. You smear it on, get a nice coat of it on there, and then you just hit it with a torch and it takes out all the bubbles. Now, if you happen to do this on something that doesn't have an edge, you see how I have the Walt Prey method the masking tape and tinfoil, but if this was an edge like we have on our bathroom sink, you just put plenty of newspaper down and let it run right onto the floor. And you can just trowel this back and forth. Boy, I wish we could finish off the Red Baron this way. One coat. This is a one coat process. And when you're done, you have just the most shiny, beautiful finish. It's relatively inexpensive, relative to buying new furniture. It's the bargain of a lifetime. Anyway, you get this drawn out as smooth as you can, but you'll notice there always will be bubbles in it. And then you have to go get a propane torch and just pass the torch. It tells you right on a package. You could, by the way, following the instructions on the decoupage package is so easy. It's unbelievable. I expect Steve DeJulia, Thomas Mann, everybody to be just decoupaging their planes from now on. Anyway, for all the women watching the videos who say, all I do is ramble on and on about planes, listen, get the old husband to decoupage some furniture for you. You'll really be happy with this. Especially if you're cheap like me, you're too cheap to buy furniture for your family. Now, the purpose of the flame is not to, absolutely, you gotta look, make sure you don't have any spots you missed, is not to heat the epoxy, but to get the nitrogen out of the bubbles. And this one pass with the torch puts a shine on this. This actually has a beautiful shine right now, even without the torch. Gets rid of all the bubbles. It tells you how to do this right on the package. Now somebody out there, hey, this table has more paint than Bob Lampione's plane. Somebody out there figure out how we can use this to decoupage pattern masters and we'll have it made. I don't know if you can see the shine on this. This is about half dry now. But it's just unbelievably realistic. It looks like marble. Look, you can see the door reflecting in it. Can you see your hand? I don't know. Yeah, you can. Look at this. You can see your hand reflecting in it. Usually you let this dry 24 hours, but the whole trick here is the torch. Believe me, this is a good trick. If you're cheap, you don't want to buy your family furniture, hey, give them the marbleizing trick. This is what the marbleizing kit looks like. It's about 14 bucks and you can do two or three pieces of furniture. Hey, just another free tip while we wait for our gold leaf lettering to dry. See this big package here? Take a wild guess what's in this package. Check this out. This is going up to my stepson, Craig Rosenbaum, Ithaca College. Guess what he forgot? Right? When he went up to college, he forgot all his socks and all his underwear. So for the last week, he's been sitting up in college with no underwear. Unbelievable. My boy. Caught in an act of sabotage, this man was caught trying to steal a canopy here. How you doing, Brian? How's that coming out? Looks good?
Yep.
All right. Pull the tape up and let's see. We'll see if the pilot died. Oh, there's no pilot in there.
You suffocated him when you
were. Oh, cockpit heaven, baby. Concourse heaven. Take it off one piece at a time, nice and slow. Where's your plane, Jim?
Behind
you. Yeah, we were all arrested by, this is the vice officer in town, George Ventrini, vice squad. What's going on here? Monday night at the Windy Crazy. Oh, there's the plane. Jimmy's working on his fillets. Brian's ripping the poor pilot's head off here. You gotta make it look professional, guy. Pro stunt. Couple neat things in the mail today before we get on with the day's work. This absolutely is a beautiful plane. I think it's Bill Rich's finest to date. This is his new plane. I like the stripe going down the body, much like the old tradition Bob Gieske. Nice canopy, as always, Bill does nice canopies. And of course, the completely buffed out finish. Hope we get to see this at the Nationals. Bill Rich's new plane. Now, I don't know if you can really see this. This came from Bob Martens, good friend of mine. He's always full of little helpful tips and antidotes and cures for cancer and whatever.
He was the one that came up with the black machinist ruler. This is a hinge slotting tool, and I'm going to show this real quick on the video. This is something I really wish I had when I built the plane. It contains a Dremel shaft with an 1/8-inch wheel collar so that you can get the slot right on the edge of the table and just work your way right into the slot. I'm going to send this into Stunt News so they hopefully can publish it. It's the kind of deal, and here's the thing in real life. I think you could make your own relatively inexpensively. Bob, of course, made this one for me. And we'll be using this as soon as we have to go cut some hinges, which probably won't be too far away. One of the planes here is going to need hinges pretty soon on our Monday night classes. Well, actually, all the planes are getting finished up now. We may be sorting some new ones. But anyway, there's some shims of various thickness, and of course, there's one and then double the thickness for each size, so you can go thickness and a half, thin one and a half one. Shims and a hinge sliding tool. This will be published in Stunt News, I hope, pretty soon. And we'll put it on our video as soon as we actually get to use it, which let's hope isn't too far away. Now, we get so many of these neat little tools and ideas, and of course, I pass these all on to Tom Morris, goes without saying. Hopefully, he'll get use of them. This is another one. This came from Walt Russell. We've used this 100 times on a video. A center line lineup tool, and I just a suggestion if Walt Russell's listening, hey Walt, listen, this would be a good thing to draw up a little diagram like that and send it into Stunt News. I have used this tool over and over. You can make the tool for scrap plywood, zero, and one Allen bolt and a knife blade. All of these little things go into making a nicer, cleaner, neater, more professional job. It makes working more fun, whatever. The other thing, and this is one that Bob Martin sent in, it's a black ruler. Where the heck's the other one? Here, we've been using this every day in the shop. And he sent me a big one. The idea being you can see the numbers a lot easier and cleaner than on a silver machinist ruler. And these things are just awesome. They work. Once you work with good tools, you say, the first thing that goes through your mind is, what the hell was I thinking? Why didn't I just go out and buy one of these good rulers in the first place, save my eyes, save the aggravation, let the model be better, whatever, whatever. Now, we hope we're going to use this doing the ink and electro sets on a plane. We're about at the point. I got the original mock-up of the lettering from Walt yesterday in a mail. He's going to do the final sketch for the lettering outline. So what we're going to do in the meantime is put on some electro sets and some little trim artifacts around the plane. And I assume a week, week and a half, I'll have that back. And then we'll go into the real heavy-duty gold leaf work. I also found out, and this is the kind of thing you really hate to find out this late in the game, that a guy that comes to our class on Monday night on a regular basis, in fact, he was here last night, Mike Costello, used to do gold leaf for a living. Well, too late now, Mike. So anyway, the point is, it's a good idea if you're going to do something unique or new or whatever, rather than bust your ass, go out and find somebody that's knowledgeable. Walt Prey certainly is the king of everything, of gold leaf and whatever. And try to work with them, try to pick up the techniques, try to improvise, and we've seen how we've tried to improvise on this. But always try to get the information from the top guy that you possibly can, just to make it easy on yourself. And what I'm going to do now for the rest of this day, I only have about an hour left, is lay out some of the small electro sets on the plane, and just try to get a little feel for how that's going to look, how it's going to work. Maybe even get a little clear on a number 7, see if we can bury that in clear and see if it's going to pick up the leaf or whatever's going to happen. It's just, we're at a point now for the next week or so, I got to play with all little details. But by having this week, the positive thing is I'll be looking at a lot of little details and spending, taking my time doing things that normally I'd try to, once I get the gold leaf done, man, full speed ahead, get the clear on and buff it out. Well, now I kind of can relax and enjoy this a little bit. So, that's where we stand today. We're going to lay out some electro sets. Now what I got from Walt, let me just show this on the video real quick. Walt sketched out about, I don't know, 6 or 8 or so, different kinds of lettering, different styles. And then I picked one out from the set and I asked him to make me up an official stencil, which I'll then transpose onto here. But these are some of the, and I'll show this real quick. I want to make a project out of this. And now, of course, we're going to try to do this up in gold leaf. So let me get a little, just a little look at this. Now you can see some of the different styles of lettering he sketched out. I'm sure he put a lot of time and love, actually, into this. This is really a complex thing.
Yeah, he's working on that. I guess within a week or so, we'll have the final mat, or whatever you want to call it, I can mask off. But in the meantime, I have a lot of little details that I want to work on. Notice number one, I'm working on the details of the bottom first. I got a number 80 this is. No, this is a 60 pen. Number 60. I filled it up with clean ink, and what I'm going to do is start doing some of my detail work on the bottom. I obviously don't want to start on the top till I get all my techniques down pat, all the things I want to figure out on the bottom. So I'll put these Strega drawings away. Hey, check out the Mustang. This was at the 91 Team Trials. Checking out the 91 Team Trials tapes. Some lucky customer is getting a nice set of these tapes in the mail tomorrow. Anyway, we want to work on some of the details at the bottom. We can practice up our ink work. You notice what I did on this bench that we have? I laid out all the templates, start looking at the different sizes and shapes and whatever it is I want to do. And this is just a question of, it's like decorating a Christmas tree, really. Not a whole lot. Now, one of the first things I did is I want to put the normal shields that I normally put on a plane. I want to make a pattern. This is 32nd plywood. I want to trace this out on here, and all I need is a pen. And I can cut this, and I can actually use this for making the ink line, the outline, in one stroke of a pen. Now, these shields, you could obviously make your own custom shapes. And then I'll run the tape up on them. This has been done before. I think if you go back over the old tweener videos, actually pretty much of them, we have patterns for each ship. This is going to be a new pattern, a new design that we use, and then we're going to checkerboard it. Checkerboard it with an ink pen. Now, of course, I'll just cut this out on a jigsaw and get all the edges. Whenever you make a pattern that you want to use to do ink lines, the edges have to be perfectly smooth. Now the idea is you have a custom shape. In effect, you're making your own template for doing ink lines. You can make a little trademark, anything you think is appropriate, you know, a woman's brassiere, a woman's underwear, I don't know what this is supposed to be, an arrowhead, a fish head, whatever. But now we got to get all the edges sanded nice and smooth and get some holes cut in here so we can tape this in position and ink from it. Now the idea here is go back into my pile and I'll put these all back in the box. Remember the old cardinal head, bird head, the little griffins, the number fives from the Red Baron. Save any of the other bird head, any of these templates that you make. Now this will be a permanent one. All the little shields off the little cardinals. Save everything, put it in your box. But the next step is we got to get a sanding block and carefully get all the edges nice and smooth. Now you think this takes a long time. It actually takes a shorter amount of time than you really think. And when you're done, you have a permanent little trademark you can put on every plane you make. And obviously you could make a new one for each plane if you wanted to. But these are the little details that, and I've said over and over again, never rush. Right now, the fact that we don't have the lettering template, we'll be more inclined to really take our time from this point on and get all the little details in order. Now what you might want to do, and these are the people that are really the up-and-comers like Borelli, and just to name a few, you might want to, the first couple times you do this, in fact I'm going to do it right now, the hell with it, I've been doing this for a long time, just run a test on a piece of paper. Because what'll happen is, as the pen runs along the edge, if you catch an edge and it goes chink, chink, you'll catch a bad spot here. Well, you'll really have a problem. So just run a test, take out, and I'll fold this back and run a piece. Do we have any paper? I wish I was wealthy, I could afford paper.
And I'll just take the ink pen and see what this looks like once I trace it out, see if I have any bad spots. You'll feel a bad spot. It'll just go by and go chink, bink, and that's... And you'll want to kick yourself right in the dupa. Okay, that feels pretty good. But if you found the bad spot, obviously clean it off with sandpaper. All right, we're ready to cut some holes in here so the tape can hold this in place. And then we'll be ready to start lining up and find out exactly where we want to put these little shields. Okay, I just cut a little window out of here, lose the piece of plywood, get the edges cleaned up. Again, you can really be creative here. This is an area where custom ink line work, you can really, really be creative. And this is what, to me, separates the planes that almost win from the planes that keep winning those concourse props. All these little unusual, neat little tricks and tips. Now that's so we can tape this into position. Again, I'm just going to double check. I don't have any rough edges. I want to get 1/8 inch tape and outline this just a little bit set back. The idea being that I can then keep this up off the wing so I don't run the pen and the ink runs down under the edge. Now generally all you need is 1 or 2 thicknesses of the thin tape to make that little riser. And if I was you, I would just go right around the edge, go back in about 1/16 of an inch. Go 2 thicknesses thick and I think you'll have it made. And you can really come up with some really nice creative designs. You're not limited to, you know, whatever. Doing squares or rounds or polka dots. You can make shields and bird heads and you can be really creative if you just have the technique and you do it once and you're successful from that point on. A whole world of custom designs works out to your favor, actually. Especially if the other guys aren't watching the video and they want to do it the hard way. Hey, God bless them. Let them figure it out without Wall Praise help. See, now I just leave gaps here in the corner. The tape doesn't have to be an exact... I mean, you're not making a... Don't bother making it too crazy pretty. Just get it that it works. And you can leave a little 1/16 or an 1/8 inch gap in between. But the idea is to get the whole template up off the wing so you can get a nice clean ink line in one shot. Now on Ski Dombrowski's plane, he did the whole root of the wing in one shot with one big giant clear template. Taped it in position and went around the whole outline of the wing in one shot. Really an unusual treatment, really looked nice too. And of course won the concourse. Okay, that's ready to use. Now from this part on, part of what happens is you have to start playing art student. You want to clean this whole area up with M600 and then start to look around and see, well, do you want it out here, up here, frontwards, backwards, sideways? I've traditionally put the shields in this position, kind of a traditional thing, and I think that's where we're going to keep them. So I just can put this in position, kind of measure it off in a couple different directions, make sure it's straight this way, and once I'm happy with where it is, I can shoot the outline on there. Now this is the point where I have to Windex my glasses and make sure my eyes really start to bother me after doing this for a while. Yeah, this is what happens when you watch too much pornography when you're a kid, you know, you get blind when you're old. All those porno movies ruining my life. Could have been somebody if I didn't do that. Anyway, I want to make sure, where's my ruler? I want to make sure that I'm in alignment this way, so I take some reference numbers. I want to be 3 inches away from the fuse. So let me just position this real easy, slow. 3 inches will be an easy number to remember. Just touch it down, 3 inches to the point, that'll do it. Now let me get a reference to how far from the leading edge I am. 2 1/4. Okay, 2 1/4 and 3 inches. Press that down nice. Double check again that we're at 3 inches. And went just a little bit off. Just a drop of water in the sea. Get my piece of paper for getting the pen working on. Now see, the template is held in place by the tape. And if you do, okay, now I always keep that little thing with alcohol handy. I see I got a little bit of a smudge over here. Sometimes you're better off just leaving it and wait until it dries. When it dries, you can get it off with a razor blade. Now see how smudgy this is in this corner? This is why we do the bottom first, to get your technique. I just touched that a little bit too much and it left a blob of ink. I want to make this point more accentuated. I can, by doing the bottom first, I can always get my feel for exactly, do I like this? How's it working out? Now what I want to do, I want to take the old machinist ruler and put tape on one side, so that I can use both edges of, and two layers of tape will be just fine, by the way. I want to use this to set up my checkerboards. And a machinist ruler is absolutely the tool of choice, unless you have some kind of special made, you can make plywood pieces or whatever. Get that taken care of. In fact, one of the things, you want to have as many of these little tools as possible. Especially if you want to do this. Bill Rich called me one day and he said, oh man, what a pain in the ass masking off these checkerboards. And when I told him about how to do it with an ink pen and with this ruler, bingo, checkerboards on every plane. It's a piece of cake. Now what we want to do is connect the two points. Step one, let me get the old pen out here. And of course the ruler just conveniently is exactly the right size. And we're running this middle thing. I moved it a couple times to get it so it would run right down the middle of a cap strip. That was one of my goals. Okay. Now you can see what I've done. If I had a helper here, it would be very easy. All I would have to do is have him hold a ruler. Since I can't hold both at the same time, I just tack it down with a little piece of tape. Always wind up doing something crazy here. Trick number two with any ink work. Let this sit till it's dry. Let it sit a few seconds and then peel it back, because if you run this into the wet ink, meh. Just let it dry for a split second between ink lines until you get your technique down pat. Okay, and boy, if you have good eyesight, this is really a time when it shows. And of course, it's pretty predictable. You just go one line after another. Try to end at nice, even spots. It's like being a draftsman. But we're always practicing on the bottom first. Now, the beautiful thing is, once you figure out all the pieces of this puzzle, you can really do some creative stuff. You could even cut the whole lettering out of a piece of 32nd plywood, which I haven't discounted that idea yet. Maybe I'll do that with Walt's stuff. Cut the whole lettering out of 32nd plywood, ink it, and then mask it off and gold leaf it or paint it. All kind of options, as long as you have the basics down pat. And again, just let it dry. Two or three seconds is enough. You don't want to drag the ruler through that ink. Line it up with the last line. If you use a machinist, this will be the Bob Martens official checkerboard. And you always want to try to not put your hand back into the part you already inked, so you don't get any unnecessary fingerprints. This doesn't take that long to do. Once somebody walks you through it, you'll be an expert in nothing flat, that's for sure. Now you want to make sure all of these lines are basically dry before you lay the ruler back on and do this segment. The reason being, you don't want to have any little wet spots that you pick up and drag across the emblem here. So we'll let this at least make sure that it's as dry as possible. Try to get this 90 degrees parallel, because once you set up the first one, it sets up all the future ones. And get the same distance between these two front pieces. Again, you could make diamonds. If you put these on a convergent angle, you could do diamonds. All kind of creative stuff, you know, but you need the basics. You need to know how to lay the foundation for some of this creative stuff. Now let's hope you pick up some good bait. Let's hope you give me some good ideas. Anywhere you can get ideas is okay with me. Let it dry, and we'll just go on and repeat this right down the whole thing. Now if you see you're having trouble getting the ink to stick or your smeary spots, you could rub a little talcum powder, number one. You could wait for everything to dry, rub it with talcum powder, that'll take out some of it. Or before you go and do this, you could wipe the whole area down with M600, of course. You could even, as a final resort, take some 1200 sandpaper and just smooth it all out. All those things will contribute to nicer ink lines. You can't do ink lines over the Grand Canyon and the Rocky Mountains and whatever. It's got to be kind of smooth to begin with, I guess is the right word. And we'll just keep moving our ruler up, getting this in place, and then it's a question of playing like a coloring book. Color in every other opposite square. You could leave one row of checkerboards out, which we'll probably do on the front, on the top, I don't know, and leave, you know, Midgley's Masterful Motors or, who knows, you know, Pablo's Prostitutes or something. You could do all kind of creative stuff. Just some ideas you could have. One thing you'll notice, the more of this you do this for an hour or so, and all of a sudden, ding, boom, bang, you're going right through at 100 miles an hour. It definitely is something you just develop a feel for. Now, if you just take an average, and again, this is a 0.60, and one by one, fill in the blanks, fill in the dots, whatever you want to call it. Just a good way to build up your patience. And I, of course, don't go and do the front first and put your hand through it. Once you do a row, skip and go to the next row. And what I do, I just get a little puddle of ink started and start working out toward the lines. Usually by this point, it's nice and relaxing. It's like basket weaving. This is great if you're in a mental home or something. You can sit and make checkerboards in your sleep. Great idea. I guess I'll prepare for my old age. What old age? I have an old age. Even Peggy Ortiz says I'm getting too old. Peggy, you're right. Those gummy bears took about 9 months off my life. Anybody doesn't know, for Christmas, Joe and Peggy were here, and she gave me a pound of gummy bears. She knows I'm going into early stages of diabetes. So she brings them over. My willpower held out for about 25 seconds. By the time they left, I ate the whole pound. I was in sugar shock for a week. Anyway, you can pretty much figure this out. Now, it's kind of puddly to do it this way. You got to really just sit back and let one panel at a time dry. Now, as you do, I'm filling in the last of the squares here. As you finish this up, hey, Pavarotti, you're okay. As you finish this up, it's a good idea right now, when you get done with one segment of the checkerboard, take at least a 10 or 15 minute break. Go do something else, because this ink is still going to be wet for about 15 minutes. And if you wind up touching it, or you see this is still puddled, you'll jiggle it, you make a mess, boom, you got a two-hour job to clean it up. Good time for a coffee break. There's one little spot here, and after the ink dries, you can kind of razor it right off. Of course, Big and Clumsy put his finger in here before. Obviously, another good idea is when you're doing this kind of work, keep your hands clean, wash your hands. As I'm saying that, mine are filthy. You want to get nice points up on the tips of these things, just do it with a razor blade. Razor in the point. It's always easier to razor it in than do it with a pen. There's a spot right out here. I can see that a brand new number 11 blade will take care of squaring that up. All little details. It's all these little things that contribute to having a really, really super model. The judge picks it up and he has a heart attack saying, wow, this guy really knows his shit. Okay. Now, let's get pretty well dried up. Now, obviously, the next step, we're going to lay out this one over here, make sure we're the same distance from the fuse side, the same distance front or back to the trailing edge. Lay out the pattern, get the little ruler out, scribe all lines, fill in the checkerboards. Basically, we're repeating the same thing that we just did on the first piece, and we'll just skip through that on the animation feature. Now the last step here is there's just a couple little spots I want to touch up. The front is still wet, so I have to be real careful. I kind of ginch this a little bit. And I want to go back and scratch out, there's two or three little spots where the ink ran over. Put a little bit of clear on each side of this, and that'll probably be it for today. I also got one little spot here with the white I want to touch up. Again, this is that ongoing thing. Touch it up as you go. Don't wait to the very end. Yeah. one thin coat of clear dope here. This will cover this up, protect it while we work on the rest of the plane. All we do now is hit our vacuum machine. And the spray dust is gone in a matter of minutes. Hey, we're at the end of another beautiful day of making big ones out of little ones. This is why it pays to make these kind of tools and benches and have supplies and just a lot more fun to work that way. We have our two checkerboards on here. And I'll bet Debbie Borelli is saying,
"Oh, Jimmy, put them on your plane too."
Anyway, we have these on other planes and I like them. I like the look in the air. And tomorrow, I don't know if we're going to work down here tomorrow, but next time we get a session, we'll do the top and get some more of the details. We have some stuff to put on the nose, ink lines here and there, Letra sets, whatever. Now today, what the object here is to ink the top of the plane. One of the things I have is right here at this part of the, where the fuselage joins the wing, the paint's a little rough, so I'm going over it with some M600, some 1200 sandpaper. Just get the thing as clean as possible, as neat as possible. We use the same template, of course. Okay. You always want to ink over a perfectly clean, flat, smooth surface, or else you get all these little mountain tops and every damn thing. Now over on the other table, I always get myself a little cap full of clean alcohol, some clean Q-tips, the card to start with, and of course make sure that both pens are filled up with ink. Just by having this stuff all ready here, now we can get over to the plane. I've got that all sanded down nice. Get a nice start on getting, and we're basically just going to do, I'll do it on animation, we're just going to duplicate exactly what we did on the bottom onto the top. Now I'm going to let that dry, go have a cup of coffee. My eyes really bother me after doing all these little checks. You start looking crazy. I feel like I'm looking at the bottom of Billy Suarez's plane or something. Anyway, I'll let that dry, come back, mask out the outside. We got another hour or so and we can finish this, at least this part of it up today. Now do real thing. I think you did. You like a 90.
Like a movie star, you can follow the spot. Do it's logical, and you can see what I like bald-headed men. She said it before.
Well, I'll tell you, but it's just about now that you completely lose your mind looking at checkerboards. My eyes are really hurting. And I'm just going to just take a little break here. I may as well finish up this row. Boy, your eyes just go crazy. It's unbelievable. I'm looking at this and I keep seeing Billy Werwood or something here. What's going on? Billy Suarez, you did it to me. No wonder Suarez beats me at all these contests. I gotta paint the whole checkerboard. Thank you.
All right, give this a good half an hour or so to dry off. Hit it with a little bit of clear and then figure out what I'm going to do. I got a little more time left tonight. Not much. I'm expecting George over to do some work on Big Tsunami, work on the plans there, so. Now, using the same technique as the shield, I'm trying to sketch out, you know, a bird. And this is similar to the one on the Walt Prey Cardinal. I'm just doing kind of a little rip-off of it. I was rearranging it, trying to make it a little bit different. And what I did, I came up with this little pattern. The way I made this pattern, I folded it, of course, so that both sides are equal. Now I'm going to sketch in the bird's head. Got to make like a little, I don't know, like a little Eskimo bird or something here. What I want to do is I want to have something up on the nose of the plane here. And I figure, well, this is something. I just want to get a little clear on this. This is just to protect it from your greasy fingerprints or whatever. I'm just getting all the little areas here, a little extra clear where we did the gold leaf. Now I got the old bench running over there. Suck out the fumes. 5 minutes from now, we could be taping off our little design up on the front. Now I'm going to trace this out. The material I'm using is 32nd plywood. This is pretty much the same technique I used to make the shield. Again, after all that's gone on here, I have a feeling maybe I'll even try to make a template for the lettering out of this material. This just seems like a real reliable way. Now, especially if you were going to make two or three planes, you know, the same. If you were going to make all Cardinals or Noblers or whatever, you could cut the letters out. The insignias and whatever. Now this is really something I may use again. I have that little lion, a little griffin. Now I have this guy. Nose art. Some night. I know Adam Usko would like this. Of course I'll go over and cut this out. Get the edges smooth. Build it up with tape in the back. And the only thing I have to sketch in is the head itself. And what I had to do is the head of the bird, because the plywood grain's going in the wrong direction, it just wouldn't stay on, so I had to hot stuff a piece with the grain going the other way. I don't know if this is really going to work that well, but there's the little pattern, and I have the little relief so he sits up off and the ink doesn't run underneath. But here's the bottom line. I have a finishing friend here that Jimmy stopped over on his way to work. So I got a finishing friend. I'm going to try to... First, I'll sand this. You can see how rough. Remember I told you the paint was rough up on the front of the wing? Let's see if we can... Right here. It's really right where I want to put it. It's got to be rough. Anyway, I'll wet sand that down with some 1200 and then get this guy put in position.
You on?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, just let me sand this down a little bit, and then we'll get this guy laid out in position. Famous last words. Okay. Anyway. I always want to start with the paint smooth and with the paint clean, some M600. Get into the duct there. Okay, and I notice I'm doing the muffler side first. This side will be half
obscured by the muffler. So if you're going to have a mistake, let it be on this side.
Just hold the plane, James, and let's see if we can... Now, what I want to try here, I'm going to put the ink on first, and the idea is I'm going to backmask this, spray this gold and try to put gold leaf in here, and then use the template itself again after the job is done to put the final ink line on with a thicker pen. I'll use like an 80 pen. Because I want to actually try to do the letters with the plywood, I think. But we'll find out. See, if you Walt Prey, you have good brush control. You could do this all by hand, but I can't. But this is actually for a guy that doesn't have a lot of good brush skills or art skills or whatever. This would be a good way to do it. All right, just let it dry.
Now this is just the outline. Now I want to make a mask for this so that I can actually back mask. I'll use the pattern itself, trace it out on a piece of paper, and use that to back mask.
Now what I'm doing, I'm just taking the same template, an ordinary old piece of, this is Xerox paper, writing paper, whatever you want to call it. This is just a mask pattern, and then we'll rubber cement this on. Now it doesn't matter if we go over the ink line. The ink line is only there so we can line this up. Because when we go over it with the wider pen, and we should get, even it all out. This is more of a roughing it out kind of an operation. Now I'm cutting this pattern on with a brand new X-Acto blade, and what I'm trying to do is leave maybe a 64th of an inch of paper out over here, and that amount could vary obviously by the thickness of the ink line, but I want to leave that amount on there. Then I'll touch up any little spots that still come out, just take a little bit of masking tape, little piece. Like in carpentry, you say leave the line on or take the line off. Striptease shows. Put your underwear on. Peggy, I'm sorry. Take your underwear off. Okay. No more gummy bears for Wendy. Okay, we'll cut the rest of this out, leaving the line. All right, now you can see what I've done. We get here, we'll just pull a little bird out, a little bird.
I knew where it was. Hey, hello, Krista. He's in the middle of something right now.
Okay, what this is, common, ordinary, old rubber cement, you know, the stuff you buy, I don't know where the price is on this, like a buck for a can, well, buck, good guess, 98 cents. Good old-fashioned rubber cement.
Big. No, that's right. You do the whole area anyway, right?
Just do the whole. Jimmy's watching this for the first time. Just do the whole area. Don't be cute. Don't be cheap. I'm going to give that a few minutes to just cook up. One thing good about this, you can reposition it a little bit if you get it in crooked on the first shot. Yeah, not too bad. Now the trick with getting the rubber cement off, always at least that I've had, is always start in the middle and work your way to the corners.
Don't start in the corners and work to the middle. Work from the middle out. We got a little bit too much rubber cement on here. This is why you do the muffler side first. And just little by little, it'll just... This thing's going to be a problem right there. That's okay. Get all this stuff off. Nothing high-tech here. You don't need anything really scientific here. Let this stuff just ball up. If you have a complex trim job, this is one real easy way of doing it, needless to say. Chewing gum. It's terrible. And now, what's real important is to get in the edges and the corners as much as you can. Now, what I'm going to try to do, I mixed up some gold dope, Sig Gold. I want to spray this with Sig Gold, and then gold leaf the Sig Dope. And this is a test. Again, we're doing it on a muffler side, just in case we have to go back. We're not going to erase the video, believe me. We're just going to just do it over. And the worst that can happen here is we'll leave it in Sig Gold Dope. If it really looks terrible with the leaf, we'll just leave the mat in place. Okay, all the corners look clean. Just takes a little time, you gotta futz it. Okay, now I'm gonna spray this gold, that's the next step, and then get ready to leaf it. I'm gonna get all the stuff clean here. So let's get a piece of paper here. About right. Now try, if you can, try not to move the nose because there'll be wet overspray everywhere here, you know? Don't you? All right. Let that sit for a minute. Okay, now it looks like what I did, I dropped this, and this is the real gold, this is not the metal leaf. I dropped this in and the paint was just a little bit too wet. It's still soft and gooey here. So we're just gonna have to live with this, I guess. But the other side we'll do, we'll make it a little bit drier. And just brush it in with the cotton just a little bit. Now thank God this is the side the muffler is going to be on. You won't really notice if this is a little ginchy. Okay, let me get on that close with the macro lens. Now this is under the macro lens. You can see what really happened here is I cut the paint while it was just a little bit too wet and soft. Now I'm just going to let this dry and then obviously, I gotta let it dry before I can do the other side, and then pull that mat off. Now that feels dry, but I just gotta get the rest of the rubber cement off here. Just carefully get all this. It turns to chewing gum, so it really doesn't hurt anything.
I had no idea you could attack the rubber cement that soon.
Oh, I've done this before. This is not the new part. The new part is the gold.
I know.
Now, you can see the incline around the bird isn't really perfect. Well, we know we're going to go over the incline, but we have the template for the incline now. So even if we have to move it, and what I was going to do is try to make it three-dimensional. You know, that's another choice, too, I have. I can try to make this three-dimensional. Now, let's just see if we burnish this down. It's not all over the place here. Yeah, the idea is while the dope is still not rock hard, you can maybe, into some degree, burnish the edge. I don't know. I'd say for an experiment, this is all right.
No, that's great. The micro scratches you got, I think are going to disappear. We'll see it later.
Well, it's not supposed to. It's supposed to look like gold, and that's what gold looks like. Well, for an experiment, for a test, for the first shot, that's gold leaf on there, like it or not.
After we do 10 or 15 of these, we'll have it down pat. But that is all right. That is going to be fine. Hey, you can really bear down on that now. Hmm. Okay. Yeah, I won't touch that side now till the morning.
Let that sit there. All right.
All right, Jimmy's going to try to hold this up off the end of the other bench because we can't really work left-handed. That's the problem. As long as I have a nice finishing friend here. Of course, you could always go and buy one of Dan Winship's finishing friends, but hey, that would be money.
Tom Light.
We need more. Who sells them now? Tom Light.
Yeah. Tom, free plug for the finishing. Buy one from Tom Light. Guy's okay.
I might be cheaper.
Yeah. Well, just invite Jimmy over your house. Better yet, don't invite him. He'll probably come over anyway. Okay. Let's get this lined up.
Hey, you're the one that works for pizza. Yeah.
How far did we go on? I got to look and see how high we are on the other side.
A little higher.
The bottom line is even with the bottom of the vent.
I think you're about a quarter inch from the block line.
Around. I'm a little bit higher. Just where it is, actually. It's not bad right now. Straight? Look straight or not?
See?
Yeah, it looks pretty straight.
See?
Okay.
What are we going to do about the reverse warpage here?
I'll link around it. Okay, so just got to ink one more little spot up here.
Now I can see that there would really be a problem if you pulled this up ahead of time. See, I got a little bit of ink hanging out over here. But since we're not using that ink line other than to line it up, I don't think it'll really be a problem. We're just going to give it 5 minutes to dry. Hey, Strega 2, Strega 1, Strega 2.
Then it'd be two of me.
Oh, no. Yeah. Two pizza pies. You put a pizza by the mirror and all of a sudden there's two slices of pie. Unbelievable. Here's the other part of this. If you're going to use the template over again, the mask, get all the rubber cement off, the old rubber cement off. Don't try to use it without, it peels right off like chewing gum. But don't try to use it twice with the old stuff. It'll be all lumpy and you get ratty edges and everything. Now the only trouble with doing any kind of taping off this way, you really don't get a nice clean edge. You have to go back over it, put some clear and then some ink to really get the maximum effect. Now I'm going to rip this off. Look, it's coming right off. Okay. And this time I want to try to use a little bit less rubber cement. I made it too chewing gummy before.
They have thinner for this stuff too.
Yeah, we ought to get some rubber cement thinner. Yeah, you're right. So it'll probably be something that melts paint. Anything that could make your life easy, you know there's a downside to it that's usually four times as bad as the original problem. Okay, you just, this'll be good enough. This isn't going anywhere. I mean, this is just holding us down. You almost could hold this in place without the cement. Get some over here. Okay. Get this off. Again, trick is work to the corners.
You said I'd never seen that before. I had no idea you could do this quickly. I thought this was to wait 3 hours for the ink, for the rubber cement to dry. And
you're doing 5 minutes later. It isn't a problem at all. I only do this when it comes to little emblems and stuff because I don't like to have the ink edges on everything. But if you live with the idea that everything's going to get outlined with ink, the lettering and everything, this is fine. All right, now I'll get the gold paint and I want to get the leaf right in position. Get it ready to go.
And then I'll turn the fan on.
Yeah, boy, that'll take care of it. Okay, I think we got that pretty well under control.
Right in the top of the wing, there's a gauge there. Maybe it goes.
Okay. All right, let me get the leaf in. And by the way, this is the real gold. This is not the, whatever the hell you want to call it, the metal leaf.
Probably covered into a ship with the tissue left over. Too.
Look at this. This stuff is shit to work with, boy. Get this back.
Could you maybe make yourself a hard paper
I was thinking of that, a mat, and drop it
over it. I think use my cover with my.
Like George did the thing here. Okay.
Just a piece of paper with a window cut in it, then you can just lower it down like a frame.
Like microfilm, yeah. Well, I don't know. I bet Walt Prey has a good way to do this. Let's get the gold the hell out of here while we're doing this.
Let's not get the gold.
Oh, the gold's blown away. Walt, save me.
Ah, it's gone.
Another $6 worth of gold leaf down the drain. Save me. Ah, that ain't gonna work. Shit. Unbelievable. I wonder if you can do this with a sheet. You think it's worth trying? I don't want anybody on the video thinking I'm a putz. They all do anyway, so what's the difference? Okay, here we go. Worse than before. That's okay, let's just cover it up.
This one will have more texture.
This is the side you're going to see, so it's not the end of the world. Let's get some cotton and blot that down. Well, ladies and gentlemen, this is how you learn. You got to make mistakes. You got to practice.
I'm going to be able to double layer. It's not sticking, so it's going to come
off. Yeah, it's going to come off. I just want the dope underneath to get some kind of a little grip on it. Let it sit for a minute, and it will burnish it. Yeah, I know. Well, like I said, the worst that can happen here is we'll double leaf it. That's definitely sticking. I guess the risk is if it's better to have it like this than it is to have it that you don't have enough dope underneath. It's going to come off at some point in time. That's the worst that can happen.
Like you lost a piece there.
I lost a piece up in a corner. Let's see if we can recover our error.
There's a piece on the pad there.
Yeah, let's see if we can do this. I don't know if we can do this.
You can't even breathe at this stuff.
Right? No, it's microfilm. That's like microfilm.
There you go. Not really. Oh, that's off the mask. Okay.
Yeah, see, now I'm leaving big scratches in while I'm doing this. That's the problem.
Well, it's got folds and stuff in it, too.
Yeah.
But that's part of gold leafs on some jobs.
Yeah.
Sometimes you go for that.
I just don't want to have any white paint showing through. That's all. I can touch up the little spots with ink if I have to. And this is giving it a better bond to the stuff underneath, too, I hope. Hope. Okay.
Going over here.
Yeah, I see that. Yeah, there's a bad spot there. But that's already, what happens is by that time it's already dry and you can't get back to it. I see a big, thanks Big Jim or something there. And I'm trying to get this with the macro lens. You can see how many scratches are actually in it when you look up close. Now, as this dries out, I'm going to try to burnish some of it off, but I'm going to give it a 5 minutes or so to dry. Let's see if we can get this mask off in one piece. Which way did we do it before? This way.
That way.
Just pull a mask up slow. Come on, puppy. You can do it. Okay, now we get to the top, we can pull it backwards. We don't need the mask anymore, so what the hell's the difference? That's all I'm worried about.
Hey.
Let's get... Boy, this shit sticks to everything. Unreal. Yeah, under fluorescent lights, you're not going to really see this. The effect isn't going to be as dramatic as it is going to be when you put this out in the sun with clear on it, and it's all buffed out with Gorham's. All right, we get all the rest of this rubber cement off of here. And then where's a nice clean cut in here, get a final burnish on it. This seems like, from all these little experiments, the most critical thing is how long do you let that dope dry before you put the gold leaf on. That's what
what needs to be exact. And I guess that varies from day to day, just like anything to do with paint. Yeah, tomorrow I'll put, I can't do it tomorrow. Tomorrow's a rug day. Hey, tomorrow is an all-day rug episode up in the train room.
Yeah, you got a lot of rolled over edge there. You might want to try to just push out or something.
Yeah, well, I can make that incline bigger, and I can three-dimensionalize it, too.
Yeah, it's going to be just fine, even with the double gold.
I think it's going to be okay. I think when all the little ink and everything's on here, I think it's going to be decent. And, you know, it's an experimental thing. Everyone's going to be better than this from this point on.
Yeah, that's going to look nice when I get the ink on it and everything. Just putting a cowl on to get an idea of what this is going to look like. Big Bird here up on the cowl. We've named him Thunder Chicken. Jimmy Chicken. Midgley Chicken. Okay, this was a good session. I think we learned a lot. I think we're well on our way to being able to do a decent job with the gold leaf, something Walt Prey can be proud of anyway. And we're developing this technique with the plywood numbers. Looking forward to trying a lettering on this. Now, somewhere on his video set, I don't know if you remember, I was stripping down this railing, and boy, it really did come out nice, I have to tell you. That's one of the things I used the plane on. Just one of the other little features, one of the things you can do with some of these modeling tools. Now, luckily, tomorrow is the day. We're going to get all the carpet put in here, so we'll lose a day from the modeling to get the carpet done. We got a lot of little things done. George finished up painting the skylines. We got skylines and things back here with the train, so. Oh, by the way, in case I never show, check this out. Pro Stun Products by Windy. Hey, check it out. I don't know if I can show what's down in the corner here. Midgley will like this. Look, way down in the corner, Welch Fluorocarbon. That's Midgley's business. Up here, Ventrini's business. Aluminum anodizing. Anyway, we got the trains cooking along here, having a lot of fun. Actually, it's been a lot of fun working on this project. I really have enjoyed it. But we need to get that floor done. Ugh, the floor. Gold leaf the floor or something here. Yeah, I hope you enjoyed that little trip back to nostalgia, back to the 50s. Most of these trains come from the 50s, early 60s. And we got the cow car and the milk car and the who knows what, the prostitutes and everything here. Anyway, just one thing I enjoy, and I just can't wait. Believe me, tomorrow is the big day. New floor tomorrow. Woo-hoo! You can see we don't have rugs in there. On the stairs either. That's coming next week. But I've been working away diligently, and the railing, that is one of my pride and joys, this railing. Okay, I have a little bit of time here, and what I've been doing, I've been playing with ink. This one isn't done. I've been just playing with some of the artwork. Take a look at this side here. What I've come up with as far as ink goes. I don't know. I'm gonna go back and forth until I really, really become happy with this anyway. I'm just inking in little lines, and I put the bird's eye in. Just trying to get some ideas here. You know, the whole deal here is get some ideas. And then I'm going to fudge around here and just try to get this, as slick looking as I can. Now here's the deal. I don't have Jimmy here, of course. I have to do this by myself. I propped this up, buried this in pillows, pulled the rudder and elevators off, so that I can work on a nose in a nice straight plane. This makes it a little bit, a little bit easier. And I can now play with the ink on this side of the fuse. Now a lot of this is just, I'm just filling in between the gold, where the gold ends, and where the original ink line is, which in effect will thicken up the ink line. Then I'll go back over it with some little thin edges if I can. Again, this is one of those things, just practice away. You just can, no substitute for just practicing this stuff. No substitute for having good eyes either. Bad enough you do the checkerboards and end up have to go into this. Oh my God. But the whole original, the theory is here to thicken up the line. Then we'll put the thin lines in the gold. We'll lube up one of those other pens. And then straighten out all the edges with a straight edge. Of course, I got to put the bird's eye in here too. Now I've just about finished up with the outside of the ink, and all I've done is get the outside of the ink thickened up, trying to bury the edge here. That's the whole secret when you do the rubber cement method, is bury the edge, trying to make his eye look like he isn't blind. It just takes time. This is artwork, and George Ventrini, my friend, who did all that nice work around the train set, was teaching me a few things about artwork, the power of observation. And all I'm doing is looking for thin spots in the lettering and thicken them up here. And we'll go back with the ruler. The curved lines, of course, you could do with the templates, or you can just do them by hand. Now you gotta watch you don't get the ruler to go back down into the wet ink. Anywhere we have a straight line, we can just get the edge in nice and straight now. And you gotta wait for each one to dry so you don't put the ruler back into the wet ink. Or you can walk around like this, I guess. Guess we can do this too, save some time. And again, now you just use that little talent you have to be creative. Figure out what looks good.
There will be no decals on this plane. I know there's people that just love to paste decals all over a plane. This airplane will be decal free, EPA registered. Not much craftsmanship in a decal, I don't know. Keep the old towel handy just in case. You'd be surprised if you just keep after it and just keep thickening up the thin lines, straightening out the straight ones. You'd be surprised how quick this comes together. Now, one of the things when you're doing curved lines, you always have to rest your hand on something. So I always either put a pillow or a fist or something. You can't work with your hand out in midair. You need to rest your hand on something. And I'm just putting in the random lines and the gold. Boy, oh boy, getting dangerous, Wendy. Okay. I just got a little bit of ink here that I didn't want. A little bit, it's a lot.
What's up?
George just walked in, so now, just when I need a real artist here, I got one, but I'm already done with this, so I guess we're going to finish this up and then get a look at George's new Tsunami, or whatever, salami, bologna, order a pizza. Hey, pizza and model aviation. How can you have one without the other? All right, just want to get a little clear on here now.
You were so...
I was just telling George the story, and it's a true story. One day I wasn't paying attention here. Of course, the phone is ringing, and everything's going wrong. And I picked up the gun, snapped it in, and it was a gun that just had thinner in it, no clear. So, needless to say, ruined my whole day. All right, that's just a little bit of... just to protect it from harm's way while we're working on the rest of the plane. This dried up nice, that dried up nice. Okay. Now we finally got, and this is Mike Aravich and another fellow. Who's the guy from that you work with? They reduced the original big tsunami down to, this is 88%.
No, it was 88% of the other drawing.
There's 88% of the 6-foot drawing, so now it's a little bit less than 6 feet. And what we're going to do is get out some Mylar and make up some, plans, some templates here so we can start building this guy. Now we pretty much got what we did with Mike Horavich's Mylar. We got the Mylar sheet, we laid out the fuse side here. And it's pretty exotic. Oh, Domino's pie! All right. Pizza time. Let's go, baby. A monumental occasion. The first parts of Tsunami are being cut out. Big Tsunami. Here's the firewall for Big Tsunami. I like that name, Big Tsunami. Anyway, First night of working on Big Tsunami here, and George has about three. We made the plans, and we got all four formers made, right? You got even the SN one?
No, I got B to do.
Okay, well, we're closing in on having the formers anyway. Just one trick you can even use on a stunt ship. We're making up a quarter inch firewall for the engine. This is going to have a 120 or a 90 or something in it. Who knows? But they're two pieces of eighth inch plywood, but I don't want the grain going front to back, front to back. I want the second piece to be on a 45 degree angle, corner to corner. So I'm going to epoxy.
I took them this morning.
Let me see. Open your mouth. Look at what happened to this poor kid. Get your hand out of there. Let me see a tooth that's missing. Brian Kiefer had to have a tooth pulled all day at Scott Smith yesterday. He was bedwetting and sleeping and crying.
No, he wasn't.
He got his tooth pulled today. Now, see what happens when you don't use a tune pipe? They pull your teeth out right on the field. Oh, God. Where's the Jeez, look at the size of this thing. This thing is heavier than Tsunami. Oh, Christ, feel the size of this thing. Now, what is this, a 4-horsepower, 3-horsepower?
2.7 cubic inches.
Oh, my God, this is $400? You could have bought a tune pipe motor for the price of this motor. Look at this thing. Did they give you a prop with it, or you got to buy your own prop?
No, yeah.
That's a real spark plug from a car up there, by the way. That's not a... look at his size compared to Brian. The thing's as big as his head. Holy maggot. Yeah, we were building some parts for Tsunami over some formers the other day.
We started to paint it the other day.
Oh, really?
George is making a picture for the train room upstairs. He just started it. This is an oil painting. The first one he's doing for me. Look at this. Unbelievable. Zenoa quartz engines. Look at this. Look at his faces in the mirror here. That looks great, George. Anyway, you got wood here too, right? You brought a lumber yard with you to make up some fuselage sides? Oh, my God. Brian, get your plane and let's check it out, right?
Now, I want to get started on doing electrosets today. I'm still waiting for Walt to return the official lettering template. Here's some suggestions, and these are just suggestions you can do to basically make your electrosetting a lot easier. Boy, breathing dust out, a big Tsunami last night. We had a great session last night, by the way. First off, you want to start on a surface that's perfectly clean, perfectly flat. That usually would mean cleaning it with M600, a little bit of sanding with very light sanding with 1200, cleaning it again with either Prepsol or M600, so the surface is perfectly flat and level and clean and dry and you don't have greasy pizza hands. Next thing is to lay out a piece of eighth inch tape. I like to practice on a piece of paper and write out all the things that I intend to write on the plane and then get Karen to edit them or somebody that has an education or speaks English well or all of the above. Anyway, just some suggestions, and we're going to start electrosetting this. One of the things I have to do, though, is make a little mental note of pretty much what I want to do. I want to keep the electrosetting to a minimum, but I want to have it in very obvious spots that it's impressive. One of the things I try to avoid, like the plague, is making a plane look like a roadmap, where there's lines and electrosets everywhere. The old division was like that. When I was all done with it, I was thinking, ugh. Anyway. Tasteful little amounts of letroset, spelled correctly, lined up. Again, there's no substitute for practice. If you have the money, it's always best to buy brand new letroset each year. Tom Lay's seem to be the best generic. They're about half of the price of regular letrosets too. The reason is they turn over fast. When you go to an art supply store, they've maybe been sitting on a shelf for 8 years. We have some gold, some white, some black. I also have the box, which I guess I've shown, now it's a drawer. I save all the old letrosets because you never know when you're going to need one more O, one more E, I, or who knows, Farmer Brown thing. You always wind up, before you lay it on a plane, look at the sheet itself and say, A, B, C, D, Dave Midgley is a dot, 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 dot. Whatever you're going to write. Because a lot of times when I first started this, one of the mistakes I made was I went out and I wanted to letter Joe Ortiz is my best friend, and I got the EN and didn't have the D. Bingo, trip to the store to buy another set of letrosets for $15, or the other choice, take the tape and take them off. Or say, Joe Ortiz is, and then leave a question mark. Anyway, kind of a little planning is in order, and what I've got planned in my mind, I'm going to try to transpose onto the plane right now. I'm going to start cleaning it off right now. I want to start on a little bit on the nose, a little bit up here, basically save most of the wing for when we know what the lettering will look like. And I have the things in my mind that I basically want to transpose onto the plane. I'll probably have to call Karen 15 times to find out how to spell them, so hang in with me. Now I'm going to sand this area real lightly. Make sure I don't have any grease or fingerprints. This is M600 and 1200 sandpaper. Get in there with a damp cloth. Get that wipe. Now, if you've put a very little paint in the colored paint, which I have, you don't want to sand too much. I don't have 10 coats of white here. I want to just get it so it's smooth, so the Letra sets stick without pressing them down and making Letra dents out of them. Now I've laid out a piece of 1/8 inch tape, and I'm just trying to see that I'm in a parallel line here. And of course you can move the tape and adjust it until you're real happy with the spacing. And then I want to basically just do a little layout here and lay this out in my mind and see exactly how I want to have it. I'd like to get it working out of this corner and working its way forward. Now notice what I did here. I'm going to write the name Tiger DeStefani, who is the obviously the owner and pilot of the real Strega. I put the video in and let it go to fast forward so I absolutely don't misspell his name, because I'm going to send him a picture of this plane, of course, and ask for his autograph, you know, on the back of a $1,000 bill or something. So this is just the kind of checks you have to do. Now, I made a little, show you how cool I am. I made a little thing of how to spell his name. Check. Notice I didn't have it spelled right. It's D-E. So anyway, accuracy above all. Now I can fast forward the video and just lose the rest of it. Now this is a Letra set pen applicator. If you look at it real close, look at this real close, and what you're going to see is there's a nylon, Teflon, whatever this soft plastic material tip. It has a wide radius. Now this is, I found this, and this is a really important trick, I found this is really good for putting on wide Letra sets. Wide ones, this is just great. See, these very wide Letra sets, very wide. That's the ticket. That's the one you always want to use. Or even Cardinal Sin here. Where else would be a good example? This word, the Cardinal here, is big Letra sets. These are good for using the wide applicator, but if that's the only tool you have, you're in big trouble. As I said, this is nice for wide Letra sets. This is another Letra set application tool. I want to get this on a macro lens here. It has a spring inside, and you can see the spring tension. Okay, I have this on about 2.5. By screwing this in, let's see if I can get this on the macro. See, I've gone down to almost to 3. Now to less than 3. I can increase the spring tension. See, now it's almost at 4. This gives me another choice of applicators. But in this case, and this is the part you're never going to find out about. This is really, really the part that's hard to figure out. This is the other tool you need. And this is just a common, ordinary ballpoint pen. It's got a real tiny point. Now, what we use this for is when I want to do these Letra sets, you'll notice these Letra sets are real fine. They're script. Or old Letra sets. Then you need to have a pen that really pushes down in one little tiny direction and really gets it in. But you have to be really careful. The broader the tip, the harder you can press. So in other words, with this one, you can press maybe 1 ounce. This one, you can press 2 ounces or an adjustable amount. This one, you can press, I mean, you can almost sit on this pen without putting a dent in the wood. And if you don't do it that way, what happens is you get a dent in the wood. Now, as the Letra sets get older and older, and of course, I have this whole drawer down here full of old junk, I'm trying to use up the new ones I bought first. But as I get to use the older and older ones, or some of the thinner ones, as the Letra sets get thinner and thinner,
you need to have a finer and finer point to press them on. So that's just one of the things to keep in mind. Keep a variety of tools. Even the big giant, the big Letra sets that are 2 and 3 inches long, this is what this paddle is for. Now, I don't anticipate using any of them. Anyway, another thing too, if you're at an art supply store, try to purchase or write to Letra Set and get a Letra Set catalog. There's thousands and thousands of optional templates, patterns, rivets, trees, pianos, toilets, everything you could possibly want to cover your plane with and turn your plane for decorating purposes. Get the cat. Now see, because I needed to experiment just a little bit to see exactly which tip I need. Now for these very fine Letra Sets, the script Letra Sets that I'm going to be writing Tiger DeStefani here under the canopy, I need the pointy pen. I need the point to get down, and I need more than an average amount of pressure. But I have to be real careful I'm not putting big dents in the wood, because then I have to fill them with clear, and obviously that adds unnecessary weight. Now under each Letra Set is this little dotted line, and that's your lineup line. That's how you line them up so they're all equal. And that's why you would want to run that piece, again, run that piece of tape on the side of the body and use the little dots to go right along the top of the tape. Now what's just happened, and this is why I wanted to put this on the video, the G goes below the tape. The G in Tiger goes below the tape, so I have to now go back in and trim this piece of tape off so I can get the G to come right down in the place that it should be. See, now with that piece of tape missing, I can get the G to just set right in. I don't want to take the whole tape up, because I always want to use both sides of this to get the Letra Sets to line up. And believe me, if they're off even a little bit, this is why it's a good idea to practice. If you have some old Letra Sets, and we have plenty, and you're kind of new to this, get out a piece of paper, get out an old plane, wet sand it with 1200 and do a little practice, and it'll be a big help to you somewhere down the road. Develop a little technique. Okay, now what my logic is here, I try to hold this in my lap the same way when I did the gold leaf. I'm going to try to get all Letra Sets done in this one area, because as I'm holding it in this dimension, for instance, if I was to flip it over now and put this side in my lap, I'm going to rub my dungarees in there full of spackle and everything else right on this side of Letra Sets. So what it's easiest for me to do is do one whole side here. Let's get all the lettering in one side. Put some clear on it, go take a break, come back, and then I'll do the other side. But this is just one of the things that, there's a compromise here. I can't Letra Set in a vertical position. I always have to get the plane horizontal. It seems most comfortable when it's in my lap. Now here's another little tip that I've been doing as I'm going along. Every time I get done with one row of Letra Sets, it seems like I have to clean my glasses. I don't know, so much dust in the cellar here. But one of the things I do is try to get a little bit of M600 on my hands, just a little bit, to try to get all the grease off my hands so that the Letra Sets stick better. Because once you get fingerprints on this stuff, you're going to go crazy. The stuff doesn't stick, and then you pound through it so hard you put dents all over the plane. Now those, luckily, don't have any dents at all. It'll take one or two coats of clear, and that'll be finished. Now I have these old Letra Sets. These are from the Cardinal Sin, these silver and gold, well, just the silver ones really. And what I'm doing, I'm picking away. Some of these have been destroyed by people that have borrowed it and tried to rub them off and couldn't get them off. But I did get a couple of them, and it adds a little variety and detail. You see the little emergency? And it's nice that I have gold set on the white. At least I think this adds a little, makes it a little fancier anyway. So I'm going to try to look through all my old Letra Sets. What I did up on the table, I laid them all out of the box. Try to find some of the little things in various colors and shapes. Kind of, this is the part of it that you can't really, you have to kind of just go along as you go and use up what you have. Now I did these with Tom Lay Letra Sets, and they go on so easy. It's unbelievable. It's almost a sin not to use them. Anyway, I took a nice fresh sheet out, even though I have a bunch of old sheets. It's amazing when a sheet is fresh how it just sticks right on, and one little rub, it goes right on and bingo. Actually, these gold ones are no bargain. I bet you these are 5 years old. They've been sitting up in Pearl Art Supply.
Now, as always, what happens is you run out of E's and I's and O's. In this case, I used a brand new Tom Lay Letraset sheet. I ran out of E's, so I had to go to an old sheet, and this is why I suggest you save all the old sheets. All I need off this sheet is an E. Again, lining them up. I'm just trying to be real careful here about the alignment. I noticed I have a little overlay. If you get a little, what'll happen is one letter that you don't want to stick somewhere else on the sheet, usually where your finger is, will stick. You need to either take an X-Acto knife, and let's see if we can do this on camera. In the M,
we have a little errant piece of Letraset.
Get this out of here and see if I can pick this out. Now, if I can't, yeah, looks like it's coming out. If I can't, I'll take a piece of tape. Take the M right out. No, it looks like it's coming out. Take the M right out, and then go over it with another M. If you need to take the whole letter out, take a piece of masking tape, cut it to that thickness, and press it right down and pull it up. The Letraset will come right up. Now, believe me, I didn't do this on purpose, Debbie. I spelt Large James wrong. I'm not looking at the sheet. I'm trying to set up video here. L-A-G-E. Well, it's large. So what I'll do is take these, get out a piece of fresh masking tape. Maybe it's good this happened. It shows you that we're all human, and you shouldn't think like there's people in the world that don't have these problems. And this will take some of it out. Now, the ones that won't take, see, these are nice fresh Letrasets. They don't want to come right off. You can just pull most of it right off. Whatever doesn't come off, you have to scrape off with a brand new X-Acto knife. Now, that doesn't look like it wants to come off so much. So I'll take a brand new X-Acto. Just shows we're all human. Just scratch it ever so slightly. Shows that we're getting a good bond here anyway. Usually the Letrasets come right off. But we're all human. Now, especially my spelling. Anybody knows the history of my spelling. Glad I didn't write the Declaration of Independence. It would have been a comedy show. Anyway, so I'll go back now to my Letrasets. Make sure I have all the letters handy. And redo this with the proper spelling. Give this a very, very careful shaving here. Get all the little stuff off. And the last little bit probably we can get off with a piece of tape. Now, once you shave it like this, boy, the Letrasets stick like hot stuff, so be careful. Next time through, they're going to stick a little better because you already have this degreased to a certain amount. Anyway, just another little thing you can get off of the videos here.
Okay, I have pretty much what I want on one side of the plant. I may want to add a little ink to this later on. I want to think about it, though. And what I did, I pirated some of the T's from Tom Lay's Letrasets to make a Large James emblem. Anyway, use them as you can. Save the old ones. Be careful pressing them down. Don't press too hard. And have one of each of the tools that you normally would use handy. Some Prepsol handy or some M600. And some tape to pull up any mistakes you make. And believe me, we all make mistakes.
Now what I did, I added a little ink around the radio boxes and some rivet heads. This is just to busy it up, give it some interest. Notice what I try to do. I try to use several different pens, make thick lines, thin lines, add some interest to it rather than just having them all. One of the things I think is a mistake to ink a whole plane with one size pen. If you vary the line thicknesses, and of course if you don't have a lot of pens, you can take a thin pen and just double up the lines. It definitely does add a little interest to what normally would be a boring thing. It's like you're reading a dictionary.
Well, it's got some interest in it. A couple different styles of lettering, a couple of different colors. This little guy up here adds some interest around the cockpit. Anything you can do to give it a little more interest.
You know what I did while I had the Letrasets out, I put in the LJ emblem into the little eagle we have here.
So, we have one side, I guess. Oh, I did a little more back there, too. A little more with the ink, just to busy it up a little bit. Got a little bit of stuff up by the cockpit here. And again, I'm just going to go over and over, and as I, you know, decide exactly where and how I want to letter this, well, you know, this is where it just takes time. We're just going to grind out the yardage here. This is just hour after hour of just sitting here patiently.
Now, here's an important thing to remember. I wanted this lettering. I really haven't spaced it out in my mind. I want the word World's Record Holder to end right at the emblem, the eagle. So what I do, I put it in backwards and try not to spell it wrong, or spell it ass backwards. And I'm working my way backward with the letters, and it'll end somewhere up here. But if I started here and the last letter ran into the eagle, no good. So whenever you want to end at a certain spot, just start at the where you want to end and work your way backward. That's another good tip.
Now you can see what I did. I worked my way backward on that too, because I don't want to run into the eagle. Now I'm getting used to working with these gold letters, these thin letters, and absolutely have to use a ballpoint pen and just press very easily on them. That's the whole ticket here to these thin script lettering. Anyway, we got quite a bit of lettering on today. George is coming over to work on Tsunami, so I'm going to kind of just see what I can finish in the last 15 minutes or so here and then clean up this mess. Boy, when you work on letter sets, they just wind up everywhere. Just unbelievable. They're just everywhere here. I can't believe it. But I'll spend the next couple days. Again, if you do it in little shifts, it seems to go. You're definitely not going to be able to do this all in one day. I can't, anyway. Now, I want to do some of the white lettering. It's easier to do these big sheets, especially the little tiny letters, if you just cut them in half. Rather than trying to work with the whole big sheet, you keep bumping into everything. Again, this is a good time to get out the old Reno Air Race books and look for some neat things you can letter set on a plane. Usually one of the problems you run into is you run out of ideas more than anything else. I just sanded this and I didn't clean it. Clean the last of the fingerprints off there anyway. But again, these little ones, I've been trying to use the pen to try to get a nice even edge. In this case, I'm using the yellow line as the edge. I want to look through this. Again, just time-consuming and patient. If you try to push hard, you get those little dents. In fact, here's one. Now, good example. I got a bad one here. Tear off a little piece of tape. Pick it right off the surface and start again. This is because we don't have this I really should sand this more, but because it's red, I'm afraid to sand it more. I'm afraid to get the red bleeding down into the white. All right, so I know I gotta press just a little bit harder on this sheet. Even though this is a brand new sheet, this came from an art supply store. And boy, you never know how old this crap is. Okay, just standing back, getting an idea of this, how this is gonna look. Again, the best thing I can even suggest to anybody is just practice. Practice, practice, practice. This just takes a technique. It takes time to get the technique down pat, and once you do, it seems like it's relatively easy after that. Another thing I try to do is I never try to do it all in one day. I'll get one side of this fuselage done today before George gets here, but I'm sure not going to be able to. If I tried to do this whole thing on a Saturday or whatever, forget it. Now here's another thing. To get the spacing in the letters right, what I always do is use the last letter. Don't use the last letter. Try to use the last one to go right over the old one. Now we want the P, so I'm going to put the original P over the X. So now I have the spacing, well, as accurate as you can expect.
Oh, another bad one, and this is just typical. Just pick out the bad one. See, if you don't know, if you think you're doing something wrong because this is happening, well, not really. You line the whole line up, the whole line of the sheet on that line. Oh boy, this moves. Now see, what I always try to do is I have some white Letrosets on the red, I'll get black ones underneath this, gold ones on the white, black on the white, varied them. Don't try not to just take a sheet of Letrosets and plaster them all over. Different lettering styles that coordinate different colors. And this is kind of a thing, you just have to plan it as you go along. There's just really no easy way to do this other than just plan it out. Now, whatever you want to cover, some of these brand new Letrosets that we just have on here, I want to get the driest possible coat of dope on here. I just want to fog on a coat of... Not a lot of thinner in the paint, but they melt. And if you use any brand except Letroset, they always melt. It's a pain in the neck. The worst ones of all seem to be the script ones. So if you go over them, go over it real light, wait about 10 minutes, and then go to the second coat. Just want to make them... This is just to protect it while we're working on the plane. Because tomorrow we'll try to do the other side. Trying to put this paint on very dry. This has only got about one-third thinner in it. Very dry. Let it orange peel up, who cares? And once you coat it with this, then it's usually the second or third time around you can get some decent, some real clear on it. We can move this around. I'll give this about a good 10 minutes to dry and then shoot on a second coat, and this will probably do it for today. Spend the rest of the day working on Big Tsunami. You're ready to work, huh, George? You look like a man ready to work on Tsunami. Hobby shop didn't have the motor mount, so we're going to kind of work on a fuselage, I guess. We'll make some wing ribs or both. This is Big Tsunami. We're taking a break from the inkwork. Big Tsunami's got 1/8-inch plywood doublers. Look at the size of these doublers. And just like a stunt ship, I want to get the back tapered to the back instead of having that 90-degree edge. So what we're trying to do is use a lot of stunt ship technology on making this RC guy up. Just get an idea relative to old Strega here, which is the same size as old Tsunami. Little Tsunami uphill, baby Tsunami and big Tsunami. Now, the only reason I wanted to show this on the camera is this is the back of the 1/8-inch plywood doublers. There's 1/4-inch fuse sides, and we're getting used to working with big, heavy amounts of lumber here, and trying to use the same technology we use. It's almost like it's going to be a big stunt ship when it's done. this is something George and I are trying for the first time. We got this.
Shut it up.
You saw we made this vacuum table on one of the earlier videos. We're actually using it. This is his quarter inch side, eighth inch doubler, and we want to do the sanding of it. And I've got this little orbital sander, and by sanding it up here, let's turn it on. You really have no dust at all anywhere, and it does a nice job. Reason I wanted to show this is the end of the tape. We're trying to build this plane just like a stunt ship with the doublers, the end of the stress riser, mirror image body sides, plywood, and what we've done is increase every dimension from a normal plane, a normal PM. Eighth inch sides become quarter inch, 16th doublers become eighth inch, because this plane is really double the volume of a normal tsunami. And you can see how big it is. So a lot of the technology we use on stunt ships, we're gonna try to do this, and we'll probably have, from time to time, come back to this on future videos. In the meantime, we're at the end of this video, and it's all your fault. Smile, tsunami.
Yeah.